Celebrating a very special anniversary here tonight, and I'm curious what it means for you to have been giving us such beautiful animated work now for four decades.
Yes, it's quite amazing, isn't it? But, you know, given that we started out as like more or less hobbyists, and then we learned our craft, and then since then, from the earliest days, we've just been trying to entertain people. That's what we do, you know. And so this is some kind of acknowledgement of that, is a recognition of that, which is very, very flattering.
Well, I suppose our first child was really Morph. So Pete and I are still very, very fond of Morph, and we're still doing Morph. Morph's now, what, 43?
Yep.
43 years old. Keeps his looks extremely well. I think also, some of the secondary characters in Chicken Run are just great fun. Babs, you know, what a great character. Comedy lines. Even Preston in, you know, Close Shave, a very evil character. And of course, if you're looking at evil characters, Feathers McGraw, who's such a simple character but sort of evil personified. And I like those simply because they're so distinct and hilarious at the same time.
Yeah. Wallace and Gromit have become a national treasure and institution. Can you talk about what that beautiful pair of characters means to both of you and how you feel about them at this point in their journey as characters?
Yes, well, Nick's characters are absolute classics, you know. I mean, Nick Park, he invented them when he was still at film school. They are terrific characters. They've had the rare chance to grow over many years, so that relationship has grown and matured. It's a very honest relationship. You know, Wallace is quite a fool in so many ways. You know, he's nothing sentimental about him, you know. But at the heart of it, deep down, there's a very, very genuine affection between the two. But on the surface, there's amusing conflict the whole time between the dog who is far more intelligent than his master. And that, by the way, is a classic double act, a bit like, say, Jeeves and Wooster or something like that.
In an age where increasingly our entertainment is being dominated by the digital, can you talk about the rare magic of tactile physical animation and how important it is that we preserve and celebrate that unique art form?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question because, you know, it's a small difference. You know, the way we make our films is just slightly different. All the essentials are the same. Like, storytelling is the same, performance is the same. But there is something special about the human touch, which I think people value. I mean, God knows I value it. And luckily, I think audiences value it as well. I think it's because, as an audience, you can sort of understand how it's done. And there's an emotional connection between you and the invisible animator. Whereas with computer animation, digital, which God knows I also love, you don't ever quite get that because it's mysterious, it comes out of a box, and you're not aware of the human contact.
A very nice half-hour special we're working on at the moment, and a couple of other half-hour specials in the pipeline. There's a sequel to a feature film we're working on as well. So there's a lot on the slate. It's busy. It's a busy, busy studio.
Yeah. Which sequel's that?
Chicken Run. It might be Chicken Run, yeah. Yeah.
Obviously, I mean, that's a film that's aged like the finest of wines. What are you guys excited about getting to play in that chicken coop again with those characters?
Well, it's a great cast of characters, aren't they? I think, you know, what we kind of stumbled upon and created was a great ensemble piece. And you think, well, actually, you want to spend more time with them, so let's do a sequel. It's been a long time coming, but the characters are all up and ready and raring to go. So it's making progress.
No, it's amazing to have you here with us tonight. You're obviously being celebrated here for some of the amazing work you've done this past year. Starting with Honey Boy, can you talk about why that is such an impactful film and what your experience was like working with the unique storyteller that is Mr. Shia LaBeouf?
I mean, I honestly feel so privileged to be a part of that because obviously he's, you know, the amount of vulnerability it's taken him to turn his pain into beauty and art. So just to be a part and help him along and kind of encourage him to exercise his demons has been an amazing experience. And working with him is the best. he's a true G. I love him, and he's a friend for life, which is amazing. He's taught me so much.
And was there a particular moment on set that was the most intense, both for him and for you, with that story?
There was a moment when I was doing quite an emotional scene, and we hadn't really spoken that much that day. And then I was doing this scene, and it was kind of speaking to him. And he came over, and he kind of hugged me. And, like, in that hug, I kind of understood everything in that moment, and it really connected us, and it obviously helped me with the emotion of the scene, because it was such a beautiful moment.
Talking about beautiful, I think that your depiction of a family in Le Mans 66 with Christian and Catriona is one of the most authentic sort of family units we've seen on screen. Can you talk about working with them and really being the heart of that film?
Yeah, they're the best. As you say, we kind of were a little family. We would, we would go, we would have lunch together. We would hang out. We had like little inside jokes. It was really fun working with them. They're two incredible actors. So just to be around them taught me a lot, just around their energy. And yeah, I'm very glad that you say that it was effective, because it felt effective to me.
My final question, talking about a strong impact, obviously The Quiet Place, it's a film that traumatized people. We're now getting a second dose of it. How excited are you to go back to that world, those characters, and what can fans expect?
Well, we've already finished shooting now. I just did some ADR for it. And, I'm very, very excited for everyone to see it. And it's, you know, it's fun, because you already know all the world, all the characters, all the dynamics between the family members. So it's just like coming back to an already rehearsed play.
I'm so proud of the film as a whole. It was one of the best scripts I had ever read, period. I think Todd and Scott created this beautiful, important, provocative story. Joaquin's performance is exceptional. I think it's a very, very important film that touches upon, extremely important themes. And I'm really proud of the entire team that came together, from our production designer to our costume designer to makeup and hair to the crew, to everybody who put their blood, sweat, and tears in this film. It was a labor of love, and it wasn't easy, and I'm just thrilled.
And talking about themes, obviously it's one of those stories that a lot of people have projected their own interpretation on. I'm curious what you're most hoping audiences take away, what for you the true message of Joker is.
I hope that it really teaches people to live life with empathy and kindness, and be very thoughtful and aware of mental illness in our world, and really just being kind and looking at people and really seeing people.
You've already mentioned Joaquin, obviously one of the greatest actors of his generation. What do you think was so unique, so special about this particular performance that he gave us?
The way he just emerged himself into that character, I've never seen anything like it. He was chameleon-like from the jump. His commitment to the character, to the role, was second to none. He's an incredible actor, the finest of his generation, and this performance is deserving of every accolade, award, critical praise it gets.
That's my final question. There's such an amazing appetite for fans to see that story continue in one form or another. Is that something that is going to happen, and would you be excited to see that?
Joker 2? You know, it's funny. It's been reported. I have never been, I've never spoken to Todd about it. I don't think anyone's ever officially announced it. I would love nothing more, and if there is to be one, I hope I'll be asked to be a part of it.
So it's amazing to have you here with us tonight. Obviously, Rocket Man is one of those films that means so much to so many people. I'm curious now, given the success of the film and the recognition it's getting, what that means to you, what that story means to you.
Obviously, it's incredibly gratifying. It's hard not to be excited and pleased about that. You know, we worked hard. It's been a long road, and You know, you put yourself out there and you see what kind of response you get, and you know, we're at the Critics, you know, Awards, and it's sort of, you know, it's part of the deal that critics are going to step up and say what they think and they feel. But to still be here in a conversation 9 months later is really kind of cool and fun.
Talking about cool and fun, I think obviously those are two adjectives that very much describe the Sherlock franchise that I believe you're taking control of. Can you talk to us a little bit about how excited you are to get to play in that sandbox?
I am very excited. I mean, that, we'll see how that plays out. There's a little way to go yet. There's a lot to get in place in terms of schedules. And that's far more complicated than I ever, out of all the things that are complicated on Sherlock, that is one of the most complicated things there are. So we'll see whether that's next or not. I don't know. But in terms of what it is, it's brilliant. It's going to be great.
What is it about what Robert and Jude did with those iconic characters, that pairing, that you think was so unique out of all of the different versions of those characters we've seen?
Well, look, they very much their own stamp on it. And I think that they humanise them in a way that stops Sherlock becoming this sort of slightly on the spectrum kind of emotionless genius. And I think that Jude roots it down in this very kind of earthy performance, and similarly allows Robert to be his kind of charming best. Look, you know, those two guys are incredible talents, and together it's just a killer combination, really.
Fantastic to have you with us tonight. Obviously, you're nominated specifically tonight for Vox Lux. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like to make that unique piece of cinema and working with one of the greats of the industry in Miss Natalie Portman?
It was amazing. I mean, I learned so much from it, just being beside these amazing people and learning from the best. I felt so privileged to be in that position. You know, because it's stuff that you'll keep with you forever, that you learn from them. And also that set, you know, filming Vox Lux, the set was like a family. It was really amazing, and, you know, I'll never forget it.
You talk about the amazing things you've learned. What is it that's so special about Natalie as a performer, and what is the most precious memory or lesson that you feel you took away from that time you spent together?
I feel like, you know, once you think Natalie, you know, Natalie Portman, then you go on set and she's such a normal, kind, down-to-earth person. I've never thought that it means anything, but I think it's so special to, no matter what happens to you in that kind of career, you are the person you are and you never change. So I think that was so special that I saw and met her, saw how down-to-earth and, you know, really easy to talk to she was.
Had a wonderful film in this year's London Film Festival. For people who weren't lucky enough to catch The Other Lamb, can you talk to us a little bit about that story and what it was that made you want to be a part of that?
So that's a really special story about a girl who grows up in a cult and is kind of faces coercive control by this one man who tries to control all of these girls. And not to ruin it, she basically decides that enough is enough and stands up for herself. And I thought that was a really special story about how, you know, it takes that one person to say, you know what, you are strong enough, stand up for yourself. And that's really why I wanted to be involved with it. It will be coming to cinemas this year, so people will still be able to see it. But yeah, I think that's a special film about a girl who takes courage.
Just finally, my last question on that. Do you think that now is a particularly important time for those kinds of stories of particularly female empowerment, self-empowerment?
Yeah, 100%. I think now is a special time, but, like, you know, previously it was a special time. It's always a special time to sell strong stories. It's not specifically about, you know, a woman. It's just about a person being strong and having courage, no matter whether you're a male or a female. I think that's the important message, that, you know, do whatever you want.
Hi, I'm Nikki Simone.
It's amazing to have you here tonight. Can you tell us about your film, The Host? Because obviously there's a lot of excitement in that and a lot of the cast here tonight. Can you tell us what the film's generally about and where you fit into it?
So the film's basically, it's a thriller. It's a Hitchcockian thriller, and it's really great. It's probably a slow burn film, but if you as you get into it, it's really the twists and the turns. And there is one shocker in the film, which I'm not going to give away, but yeah, everyone's pretty shocked at that one scene. So, you know, you have to... It's probably my favourites in the movie, but I'm not going to give anything more away about that. I play Patricia, and she basically holds a lot of the secrets, basically, in the movie. So she kind of... She's an interesting character. I'm trying to think of the best way to describe her in the third person. She's basically the person who everyone kind of keeps. She keeps everyone's secrets. That's basically all I can really say about the character without giving too much away on the movie, to be honest with you.
We don't want you to spoil anything. But you do seem to be spoiled with an amazing cast around about. You can talk about the rest of the team working on this and what it was like working with them.
Oh, it's amazing. I'm like, Mike Beckingham was on the movie, so he's been fantastic to work with. And then, obviously, Dougie. He's been an absolute gem working alongside him. And then I was in the scene with Dominic Keating, and, you know, he's obviously quite a legend up there with all the sci-fi fans, and so, you know, it was amazing working with such a fantastic actor. Everyone's working with the rest of the cast has been a really amazing experience, and they feel like part of my family, to be honest with you, at the end of this.
How does it feel to be here tonight at the Critics Circle Awards in the heart of London? A fantastic celebration of cinema ahead of us tonight.
Oh, absolutely. It feels amazing to be here tonight. Very lucky to be here tonight. And I think you're going to see some amazing talents walk through the door as well. So it's going to be a good evening. I have a good feeling about it.
But I'm here for the first time, checking it out, and it's really quite nice. Looking forward to it.
Can you tell us a little bit about the story of the host and what it was that excited you about being part of the project?
Well, I read the script about 2 years ago. I read the script and I had a little piece in the film. And unfortunately, time was not on their side, so it had to go. But I was commissioned to write the song for the film, which we did in kind of 3-4 hours. And Zach did test my ability. And I have to say, I'm so glad he did, because you can pull out of the bag something you never thought you had. So we wrote the song, got on the film set, got my hair done and what have you, ready in no time, and we filmed it. And then the next day went into the studio, recorded the soundtrack, and it was great. Yeah, came out all right.
Of course, I mean, you've been blessed to work with some of the biggest icons in music over the years. Did you draw on any of those particular inspirations for this track, for this work?
You know what? I've been in the industry for about 35 years. What you do is you draw on the experience of your work. You know, I've been on it for a long time. And more importantly, you know, I am a songwriter, really, as well, should I say, dare I say it. And so I just kind of just did it, just got on with it, really. But, you know, I love music. I'm a fan. And, you know, given the opportunity to write the track, I couldn't say no and I couldn't back down, so I went for it.
It's amazing to have you here with us at the Critics Circle Awards. Obviously, you've got a very exciting film coming out very imminently with the host. Can you tell us a little bit about that one? Why should we be getting excited?
Yeah, sure. It's kind of like a modern-day Hitchcock thriller with a lot of horror thrown in. And we've kind of turned it on its head a little bit in terms of what Hitchcock did with the legendary film Psycho, we just kind of wanted to pay homage to it a little bit, you know, and we went out to Amsterdam for 5 weeks to shoot in some amazing locations. We really became kind of part of a family, and we kind of hope that the audiences will watch it and get taken on this journey with my character Robert, who makes some interesting decisions, makes some interesting life decisions, and what the point is, I think, is that depending if you make a decision or not, it doesn't make you a good or bad person. You can learn from it. So, yeah, it's due out now. It's on Amazon Prime. So Robert, for me, I wanted to make him the kind of humanizing, if that's a word, I don't know, the kind of humanizing element of the story. So, like I said, we've all gone through life and made a decision, and it's not necessarily defined us, but we've certainly learned a lot of things from it. And so we pick up the story from Robert, and he makes some interesting decisions, interesting choices. It leads it down a very, very deep rabbit hole. and hopefully you'll go on that journey with him.
A lot of the great projects you've been involved with have that kind of horror, that psychological dimension to it. What is it about that as a storyteller and an audience that is so compelling?
Well, I got years ago when I was doing a horror movie, I got told that when you watch a horror movie, it has the same chemical reaction in your body as love. So you kind of want to keep doing it, you know? You kind of have that sensation. So I think that's it. I think it's science. So I just finished on a TV show with Simon Pegg and Nick Frost called Truth Seekers, which is due out this year. And I'm due to start a movie with Billy Zane called Waltzing with Brando in April of this year. We go to Fiji to start shooting that in April, May time. So I'm very excited.
We're excited about that as well. That's a great pairing, you and Billy. Can you tell us anything more about that one, where you fit into that?
Yeah, absolutely. So Billy is going to be playing Marlon Brando, which is the first depiction of Marlon Brando ever to be done. And I don't think there's a better actor out there that looks and feels and suits Marlon Brando than Billy Zane. I'm going to play a character called Bernard Judge, which the story evolves around. He's an LA architect who became very pioneering because he created the first spherical home in the LA Hills. And basically, it's got a very wonderful story short. Bernard wants to build a self-sustaining property on an island. Brando's got the island and the money, so these two worlds collide in a wonderful way. It's a real feel-good story. And you're going to see a very different side to Brando in this.
Hi, everyone. I'm Zachary Weckstein, the headline sponsor of this year for Pro Pictures Productions.
This particular celebration of cinema, such a special and important night, do you think?
I think it's wonderful because we're here celebrating some wonderful artists, some wonderful filmmakers, people who've worked so hard, and their teams as well, who've worked so hard, their producers, their directors, the writers, makeup departments, and coming here to celebrate the wonderful craftsmanship of their talents.
Talking about great talents, I know that there's a particular film, The Host, that you guys are releasing to us very imminently, both in the States and over here. Can you tell us a little bit about what we can expect from that very special production?
Well, you should be expecting some thrill, some suspense, but some also ease in your brain that you won't be actually leaving the cinema with nightmares at the end of the evening, but that it can still leave you with some suspense and not knowing exactly what the actual tale will bring. So not always knowing what element will happen next, which I think is really important in storytelling.
We've heard the film described as very much a sort of a modern Hitchcock. What is it about that genre that keeps audiences, whatever generation, coming back for more again and again?
I think it's the thrill. I think it's the onion layer suspense, you know, peeling, you know, layers that Hitchcock created, as well as all these wonderful other talents have created along the years. And for me, I'm just so grateful and happy that I get to be a part of that, time classic period, you know, thriller genre piece.
And apart from that, is there anything else you've got coming up at the moment that you're especially excited about, that you're involved with, that you want to share with us?
Well, I'm just trying to focus mostly on the PR and the marketing and the distribution of worldwide sales of cinemas and everything else, but also have my hands and toes in a few things which will be coming up in the next coming years. So a little different kind of genre, more action-based, but very excited about all the things to come.
Worries about the critics.
I really respect critics, and I don't worry about it, to be honest. Like, I think for me, I worry mostly about what I do when I'm on set. That's my worry, and anything that happens after it is out of my control. But I think what they do is amazing and hard, and to give a kind of a window into what these films might mean to a wide range of audience is brilliant. But I think we're kind of all in it. I think they really care. I think in my experience, they really care about film. You know, people, they genuinely want, what we all want when we go to the cinema is to be surprised and moved and champion, like, really brilliant filmmakers, so I really respect them.
It's a big week of award ceremonies for you. How are you? Is that how you're feeling about Sunday?
No, I'm super chill and calm. What are you talking about? Jesus.
What are you hoping for then? What would mean the most?
I'm hoping I'm not going to fall in my high heels. That is my main concern. I'm hoping to have a good time. My brother's coming with me, and he lives in France, and I've not seen him in ages. And I've got him a tux, and he's going to be all suave. And like, I just really want to have fun. And it's complete and utter madness to me that I'm even a word in a world like that. And it's a real honor, and I think it's lovely to celebrate each other. To, you know, winning whatever, we're all a bunch of bananas at the end of the day trying to make like them, oh, I don't know, I'm gonna just shut up now. Something about bananas.
Last night where Gugu was, and she did mention you, said that she's working with you on it with Keira Knightley too. Are you looking forward to everyone finally seeing that? It sounds really good.
Yeah, we had such fun making it, like to have a kind of a women-driven film, and a moment of rebellion and like growth at that time in the UK. And they're both, like Philippa Lawthorpe, who directed it, was brilliant, and there was all kinds of women, you know, there. It wasn't just this sheen. It was about the voice of a woman in the world in the 70s. Yeah, so we had great fun making it. So I haven't actually seen it yet, so I hope it's a good.
What a privilege, you know, what a privilege to be asked to work with these, like, you know, icons, sort of legends of cinema.
Yeah, working with Scorsese, I mean, he's done so many amazing things, but this is such a passion project for him. I mean, that must have been a great world to be in the sense that he was so passionate and had been going for so many years trying to make the film a reality.
Do you know what? There's not, I mean, I've done 7 films with Martin Scorsese, and there's not one that he hasn't been passionate about. That's the nature of him. That's what he's like. He's enthusiastic and passionate about all. I mean, okay, I know what you're saying about this being this kind of gangster film, and I'm just really glad to have been part of it.
Yeah. Is there, in your illustrious career, you've done so many things. Is there anything that you still look to, you know, get to? Is there anything that you'd love to do in terms of maybe a superhero movie or anything like that? Or you just taking the projects as and when they come?
Them as and when they come, if they're things I want to do. And I have to admit, the superhero movie is not one of my dreams. So, you know, I'd give that one a miss.
Yeah, I mean, addressing the guys, De Niro, Pacino, because they go through various different stages of a whole life. It must have been great to tell, to costume them in different stages of that career, because they start at 30 and go up to 70, 80 years old.
Yeah, I mean, it's telling the story. It's actually bringing a character to life through their clothes and the passage of time.
Yeah. And do you get to see any of the movies that are in? I mean, there's so many amazing movies this year. Do you get time to sit down and watch them, or are you just continuously working?
I have seen them all because I'm a voter. So, you know, I'm obliged to see them all. And I've seen really a huge number of films, and it's such a great year. Very competitive year. There's some really, really good work out this year.
Yeah, anything that was top of your list that you thought was exceptional?
What do you mean, apart from The Irishman?
Of course, apart from The Irishman.
I love The Lighthouse.
Isn't it
actually
good?
Yeah.
Very unique.
Yeah.
Would that have been something that would have tickled your fancy had it come
would
your
have
way?
Actually, yeah. I like it because it's sort of got an edge to it that's interesting.
Of all the accolades that have been thrown at you in your career, what does this honour particularly mean to you this evening?
Well, critics criticise, so to be praised by critics or valued by critics is extremely special. And it's kind of surprising because I've always thought of myself as something of an outsider, always in some kind of opposition in a way, cinematically speaking, or taking a lot of risks. So to have that appreciated feels like a kind of arrival. It's very special.
Talking about very special, there's a sense that your next project with Elle and Javier is a unique story. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and what is special about that one?
Well, The Road's Not Taken, it's called, and it's about those kind of lives that many of us don't live, but think we might have lived if we'd made different decisions at crossroads moments earlier in our lives. And so it explores that theme, and through a father-daughter relationship over 24 hours. Wonderful actors.